Hello dear viewer, apparently you clicked on this video because you're interested in balloons. The Chinese spy balloon that flew over North America earlier this year reignited public interest in military balloons and reminded me of a Japanese weapon system that already crossed the Pacific in World War II. The Fusan Bakudan, or windship bomb, also known under its designation Fugu Heiki, was an armed balloon with a simple autopilot. This video will explain the basic working principles of the Fugu balloon. My sources are as always listed in the description. First I will show you what the Fugu was and how it looked like, then I'm going to give you an overview of its history, and then I'm going to explain how the autopilot worked. At last I show you how a Pacific crossing of such a balloon might have looked like. The balloon was made from a mulberry paper envelope that was glued together by Japanese potato paste. The sphere had a diameter of 10 meters, which gave it a volume of 523 cubic meters, and was filled with hydrogen gas. An automatic gas vent that managed the internal pressure was mounted on the underside. Under the balloon hung the autopilot consisting of the battery, self-destruction charge, 4 aneroid barometers in a wooden box, the switch ring, and the ballast chandelier that held 32 sandbags for incendiary devices and a central anti-personnel bomb for ballast. The ballast was held by ejectable plugs. Fuses connected the plugs and switches. The first idea of an armed balloon for the Japanese military surfaced in 1933 at the Japanese Military Scientific Laboratory under the proposed Airborne Carrier Research and Development Program, led by Lieutenant General Raikichi Tada. The Fugu weapon was envisioned as a balloon with a diameter of 4 meters and a small bomb load that was released via time fuse over large area targets. This first Fugu project was stopped in 1935, however the idea of an armed balloon lived on and limited research continued. The balloon project came under control of the 9th Military Technical Research Institute, also known as Noborito Research Institute, when Japan reorganized its army unit structure and the military scientific laboratory was discontinued. The Doolittle Raid and the increasing number of American bomber attacks ignited the wish for revenge attacks on the American continent, and Major General Sueyoshi Kusaba, who already took part in Tada's first balloon project, revived the Fugu project. In March 1943 developed Kusaba's team a 6-meter balloon armed with an incendiary device that was dropped by a simple autopilot. The balloons should be started 1,000 kilometers off the American west coast and fly in 10 hours to the shore. The Imperial Japanese Navy equipped 2 B-1 submarines, most likely I-34 and I-35, with balloon launching equipment, and the army organized 200 balloons. Both submarines were recalled in August 1943 because they were needed as food and ammunition carriers in the Guadalcanal operation and the project was discontinued. The logical next step was the development of a balloon that could be launched on the Japanese mainland and cross the Pacific Ocean. The army developed a paper balloon, while the navy focused on a balloon skin made from rubberized silk. The navy version was developed by Captain Ogawa and Professor Tatsuko Nakamura under supervision of Technical Lieutenant Commander Kiyoshi Tanaka. The Navy program became part of the Noborito Institute in 1944, where it was continued under the designation B-type, while the Army balloon got the designation A-type. Fugu Type B were often used to carry radio sondes and experiments in test flights started from Ichinomiya. The rubberized silk was deemed too resource intensive and the performance too bad, so the Fugu Type B was discontinued after 300 units were made. To accelerate development of the remaining Fugu Type A, the director of the Noborito Research Institute, Lieutenant General Shinoda, suggested to the commander of the Weapon Administration Bureau, General Mimura, that other institutes should aid Noborito in fixing the remaining issues. The suggestion was approved and the program for accelerated research started with the first meeting of civilian and military scientists being held in May 1944. Shortly after, Noborito received funding for the project. Head of the research group became Kusaba. Testing continued throughout spring 1944, and by summer, production started. Thousands of Japanese schoolgirls were used to glue the paper envelopes. The army formed a new special balloon regiment and gave command to Colonel Inoue. He supervised the preparation of launch sites, observation sites, gas production facilities, and the training of personnel for 3 battalions. Everything was ready in the winter when the jet stream gave favorable winds and the balloon assault on North America was started on November 3, 1944. On November the 4th, fragments of a Fugo Type B envelope were spotted in the sea by an American patrol craft. The payload consisting of a radio transmitter was still attached and revealed its Japanese origin. However, the balloon was misidentified as a weather balloon. Balloons were spotted through November in Wyoming and Montana. A press report from December 1944 in a Chinese newspaper about an armed balloon found in Wyoming confirmed to the Japanese that Fugo could cross the Pacific Ocean. The Americans investigated and evaluated the new balloon weapon. It was speculated that some balloons were launched from Japanese relocation camps or German prisoner of war camps inside the United States. The discovery of a bomb crater in Wyoming that contained fragments of a Japanese bomb and 4 more incidents in January 1945 led to the conclusion that the balloons were a Japanese offensive weapon. It was unclear at that time if the balloons would be used for attacks with biological, chemical, or incendiary weapons. As a reaction, Project Firefly and Project Lightning were started. Firefly aimed at the protection against forest fires ignited by incendiaries, while Lightning prepared for possible outbreak of diseases in farm animal or croplands. The Office of Censorship asked newspapers and radio to voluntarily censor all balloon incidents on January 4, 1945. Japanese propaganda claimed on February 17, 1945, that 10,000 people had been killed, many fires started, and that the American public was in panic. The destruction of the hydrogen production facilities and the lack of information on successful Fugo attacks in American newspapers led to the end of the balloon campaign in April 1945, with the last balloon being launched on April the 20th. One Fugo entangled itself in a power line to the Hanford site in Washington, and the resulting power loss delayed plutonium production. Fugo's only victims were 5 children and a 26-year-old pregnant woman that were killed on a Sunday picnic trip in May 1945. A balloon is a lighter-than-air aircraft. In contrast to airships, balloons can't be steered, they sail with the wind. That's why they are sometimes called wind ships. Only the altitude of the balloon can be controlled, and the different wind directions at different altitudes are used to navigate the balloon. 2 major forces act on a balloon: the buoyancy of its gas-filled envelope and the weight force of its total mass. The buoyant force comes from density differences of the gas-filled envelope and the surrounding atmosphere. The hydrogen-filled envelope will become buoyant in the surrounding atmosphere when its weight is lower than the weight of an equal volume of air, or in other words, when its density is lower than that of the air. The balloon will rise up when the buoyant force is stronger than the weight force. The pilot can achieve this by either increasing the volume of the balloon or decreasing its weight and thus lowering the density. The balloon will sink when the weight force is stronger than the buoyancy. This is usually achieved by venting lifting gas out of the balloon, thus decreasing its volume while leaving the weight unchanged. This process increases density. The balloon is floating when weight force and buoyancy are equally strong and cancel each other out. The envelope is made from washi paper and holds the lifting gas. The spherical shape requires the least amount of paper to hold the 523 cubic meters of hydrogen gas and reduces thermal expansion from solar radiation. Changes in altitude or thermal expansion of the lifting gas can change the internal pressure of the balloon. To prevent damage from high stresses to the paper envelope, hydrogen has to be vented. The valve is made from stamped sheet metal and covered with rubber to allow a gas-tight seal. The valve is pressed against the rim of the vent by a spring. The force on the envelope resulting from internal pressure can thus never be greater than the force of the spring pressing on the valve. The battery is encased in an insulated box made from clear plastic and placed in a calcium chloride solution that acts as a thermal mass. The clear plastic box allows the battery to be warmed by solar radiation, similar to a greenhouse, and prevents the battery from freezing at high altitudes. The battery provides power to the electric igniters in the plugs. Aneroids can react to air pressure and are used as switches that close or open at different altitudes. They are made from stamped pieces of sheet metal and enclose a small vacuum inside them. The aneroid contracts or expands when the external air pressure changes. The movement of the aneroids was used to open and close electrical circuits in the altitude holding device. The Fugo has four aneroids tuned to the altitudes of 10,000, 6,000 and 4,000 meters. The ballast ring on the lowest part of the Fugu has 72 holes drilled into it. The ballast and payload is hung from 36 little T-hooks that each rest on two of the payload plugs inserted into the 72 holes. By removing either of the two plugs, the ballast is freed from the ballast ring and falls to the ground. In the center of the payload ring is another pair of payload plugs inserted into a separate mount holding the central bomb. The payload plugs were made from machined and later cast aluminum and supported the T-hooks in the ballast chandelier. Inside is a small black powder charge that is visible in this cut. The black powder is protected by a piece of tin foil and ejects the plug from the ballast chandelier when it's electrically fired. The arming fuses are placed directly behind the payload plugs and ignite when they are ejected. The fuses are connected with the switch plugs, burn for 2 minutes and then fire the switch plug. The switch ring is placed above the ballast ring. 72 holes are drilled into the switch ring that hold the 72 switch plugs. Each switch plug holds a spring-loaded switch. When the switch plug is ejected, the spring forces the switch upwards into the contact and selects the next piece of payload to be released. The Fugu balloon sailed across the Pacific with the winter jet stream. The jet stream is a powerful wind that blows at high altitudes between 12,000 and 10,000 meters, at speeds of over 300 km per hour. The autopilot had to hold the balloon at this altitude during the crossing, which took 3 to 4 days. The balloon was thus designed to move between altitudes of 12,000 and 10,000 meters. The upper altitude level was defined by the spring in the automatic gas relief valve, and the lower altitude limit was set by the aneroid tuning in the autopilot. If conditions are right, the balloon's density and the density of the air between the two preset altitude levels is equal. Weight and buoyancy cancel each other out. Fugu can't rise above its upper altitude limit and no action has to be taken, but this is rarely the case. When the balloon is above the upper altitude level, lifting gas is vented to reduce its buoyancy. The internal pressure of the balloon is so much higher than the air pressure of the surrounding air at high altitudes that the automatic gas valve is forced open and hydrogen escapes. The ballast weight pulls the balloon down below the upper altitude level. If the balloon sinks to the lower altitude level, Ballast is dropped to let buoyancy carry the balloon back into the preferred altitude bracket. The master aneroid will close an electric contact and two payload plugs are electrically fired. The sandbag falls away and the weight of the balloon is reduced. The ejecting payload plugs ignite the fuses, which will burn for 2 minutes to give the balloon time to rise above the lower altitude level. When the flame front reaches the switch plugs, those are ejected as well and the spring-loaded switches close contact on the switch ring to connect the payload plugs of the next sandbag with the master aneroid. Those are the basic working principles of the altitude holding device. As you notice, Fugu is equipped with 4 aneroids. One of them is the master aneroid that reacts to the lower altitude level. Another, less sensitive aneroid is tuned to the same altitude. The third aneroid is tuned to 6000 meters to make sure that ballast is dropped if an aneroid malfunctions and fails to close the electric firing circuit. The fourth aneroid is the mission abort aneroid. The mission abort function is only unlocked after sandbag number 9 was armed. In case of a major malfunction that leads to the Fugu balloon dropping below an altitude of 4000 meters, the self-destruction process is started. The payload plugs for the central bomb are fired and the fuses to the demolition charge and the envelope flare are lit. The picric acid block destroys the ballast chandelier and the flare ignites the envelope and the hydrogen gas inside. The last ballast pieces are the incendiary devices and the central bomb. The incendiary devices acting as ballast pieces 33 to 35 are dropped by the same process as the sandbags, but the central bomb is dropped together with the last incendiary device and the self-destruction process is started. The first sandbag is armed 50 minutes after the start when the balloon has ascended to the operating altitude. The starting fuses are ignited on the ground and burned to the first pair of switch plugs that are ejected when the balloon has reached the desired altitude, connecting the battery with the circuit. In this part, I want to show how all the components work together. For this, I'm describing the hypothetical flight of a Fugu balloon launched from the Otsu site in Ibaraki Prefecture. The tested envelope, ammunition, and all other necessary materials arrive by train at the Otsu launch complex. When favorable winds are expected, the envelope is taken to a prepared launch pad and spread flat between the 19 anchor points, and then tied to the anchors. This minimizes the introduction of air into the envelope. The gas pipe is connected to the inflation port on the underside of the envelope, and 230 cubic meters of hydrogen gas are then used to partially inflate the balloon. The Otsu launch complex produced its own hydrogen in large reactors. Other launch sites used bottled gas. After partial inflation, the gas pipe is removed and the automatic gas valve is installed, sealing the envelope. 19 long ropes are threaded through the appropriate holes on the envelope, and one end is hooked to one of the 19 anchors, while the other end is held by a crewman. The loaded ballast chandelier is installed. After that, the crew gives rope and the balloon slowly rises until the ballast chandelier clears the ground. The aneroids are checked and half of the ropes are removed. The starting fuses are ignited. And the ropes are unhooked from the anchors. The balloon rises slowly until the rope ends are reached and fall back to the launch pad. The balloon is flying free and quickly rises to its operating altitude about 40 minutes after release. The starting fuses burn to the first pair of switch plugs that are ejected approximately 50 minutes after the launch. The spring-loaded switches shoot up into the contacts and arm the number one sandbag. The balloon rises higher and higher until its internal pressure opens the automatic gas valve and hydrogen is vented until the pressure difference is back at a normal level. The gas release increases the density of the balloon, which sinks to an altitude of equal atmosphere density. The balloon is floating stable and sailing with the wind until evening. The fading sun doesn't warm the envelope as much as it did during the day, and the lifting gas contracts while it is cooling. The resulting decrease in buoyancy is responsible for the increasing weight influence that pulls the balloon further down. At night, the balloon sinks below the minimum altitude level. The master aneroid closes the electric circuit and the payload plugs of sandbag number 1 are ejected. Sandbag number 1 falls away and a sudden decrease in weight lets the balloon slowly rise above the set altitude limit. The ejecting payload plugs ignite a pair of timing fuses, which are burning for 2 minutes. When the flame front reaches the switch plugs, both are ejected and the switches arm sandbag number 2. The night is very cold and the balloon falls again under the minimum altitude level. The master aneroid closes the contact again and the payload plugs of sandbag number 2 are ejected, igniting the pair of timing fuses. The balloon doesn't rise above the minimum altitude level during the 2-minute burning time, so when the fuses burn out, the master aneroid still holds contact, and when the switch plugs eject, the closing switches immediately fire the payload plugs of sandbag number 3. The combined loss of weight from sandbag number 2 and 3 finally allows the balloon to rise above the minimum altitude. The timing fuses burn out and sandbag number 4 is armed. The balloon loses 7 bags of ballast that night. Dawn breaks just before sandbag number 8 is released. The warmth of the sun rays heats the lifting gas and the balloon stabilizes its flight. The day is quite warm and the gas expands, carrying the balloon to higher altitudes. The internal pressure opens the gas relief valve again to prevent the envelope from rupturing. Quite a lot of gas is released during the afternoon, so that the balloon quickly reduces its altitude in the cool evening when the gas contracts. The balloon crosses the lower altitude limit and sandbag number 8 is released. The fuses burn to the switch plugs and sandbag number 9 is armed. The self-destruction mechanism is also unlocked. Arming of sandbag number 9 also armed the central bomb plugs. Should the balloon sink deeper than 4,000 meters, will the mission abort aneroid fire the central bomb's payload plugs that ignite the fuse to the picric acid block and the long fuse to the flash bomb on the envelope. However, this balloon is at an altitude of 10,000 meters far away from the self-destruction zone. Too much gas was vented during the day, so the release of sandbag number 8 wasn't enough and sandbag number 9 is immediately released when armed. The fuses are burning and sandbag number 10 is released as well, and the arming fuses to sandbag 11 are ignited. The balloon finally rises above the minimum altitude again. Night falls and a freezing wind blows. The lifting gas contracts some more and the balloon is pulled down by its weight. Sandbag number 11 is released, but one of the fuses fails to ignite. The balloon rises above the altitude limit with only one burning fuse and only one switch plug is ejected. Sandbag number 12 is armed, and with the next release command from the master aneroid, both payload plugs are ejected and the pair of fuses is ignited as usual. The balloon makes its way above the minimum altitude level. The cold night air freezes the master aneroid in open position. The balloon passes the minimum altitude, and the master aneroid can't drop ballast, but the less sensitive second aneroid closes the contact and ejects the ballast. The falling temperatures cool the lifting gas even more, and more ballast has to be dropped to let the balloon rise back to the minimum altitude level. The second aneroid freezes later that night as well. The balloon falls way deeper than before, but aneroid number 3 still works as intended and periodically drops ballast until the sun rises once again on the horizon. The Fugu balloon crosses over the North American shoreline that morning. The sun warms the lifting gas and then freezes the aneroids, while the balloon climbs to its desired altitude. The balloon has lost enough lifting gas so that the ballast has to be dropped periodically during the day. Sandbag number 32 is dropped and the balloon enters the attack mode. From now on, incendiary devices of masses equal to the sandbags are dropped as ballast. Soon only the last two incendiary bombs and the central bomb are left. The Fugo balloon approaches the minimum altitude level and drops ballast piece number 35, an incendiary device. The fuse pair is ignited by the injecting payload plugs and the balloon rises. The fuses eject the last pair of switch plugs, which arm both the last incendiary device and the central bomb's payload plugs. The balloon sinks to the minimum altitude for the last time. The master aneroid detects the release altitude and closes the contact. Both payload plugs from the incendiary device on ballast station number 36 and the payload plug securing the central bomb are ejected at the same time. Bomb and incendiary device fall down to the ground. The payload plugs from the incendiary device don't ignite any fuses, but the single central bomb payload plug ignites the two fuses of the self-destruction mechanism. The picric acid block explodes and destroys the empty ballast chandelier. The free envelope floats to higher altitudes, but the other burning fuse is attached to a flash bomb fixed on the envelope. 80 minutes after release of the central bomb explodes the flash bomb and ignites the hydrogen and paper envelope. The Fugo balloon has finished its mission. You made it to the end of this video. You should now have an idea how the Fusen Bakuden Fugo Type A has worked. Note that there are different wiring methods and variations in armament as well as another ballast release mechanism. The shown Fugo was the most numerous variant of the Fugo balloons. I want to invite you to read and watch my source material that is as always linked in the video description to find out about other modifications yourself. Thanks for watching and see you in the next video.